In Psalm 90 today, we are in the fourth week of a series called Sing a Psalm, and so we're going to dive into that today. We are specifically going to be talking about time today. It could be about an anniversary, something that is meaningful to you as far as something that you can mark this day. We'll share about some of that as we head through, but let's go ahead and say a word of prayer so we can dive into today's message. Heavenly Father God, we give you this time. We give you each moment that we have. Lord, help us to focus upon you within those moments. And Lord, help us to know that you are in control. Lord, as we dive further into these psalms, we thank you for them. We thank you for the writers. We thank you for writing them into songs so that we could actually sing them, or the verses that Jesus would share through psalms. Lord, there's just so many different ways in which we can use these psalms in our everyday lives. Lord, teach us to do so. We just give you this time together. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. So I have a lot of weddings I have coming up. That's part of the role sometimes as a pastor, that is to do weddings. And so I had one yesterday, and I have to tell you that the roughest time going into any wedding is the final couple weeks, and it tends to get worse and worse the closer you get to the day, until something happens, and I don't know what it is, but it's usually the day before, sometimes it's the morning of, where something just breaks and everything just seems like it's going to be okay. So you never know when that's going to come. I try to warn all the couples about it. I try to share it with them. You know, it's specifically more so for the bride, because the bride has been thinking about this since they've been a little kid, and they want everything to be perfect. And so they will normally try to have mom help, or soon-to-be mother-in-law help. And, you know, sometimes they have different ideas than what they have. And I tell people all the time, listen, it's great that you have a mom, and it's great that you have a mother-in-law, but it's what you want at the end of the day. So even when it comes to the time of the rehearsal, I tell everyone, I'm on the bride's side, even if she's bridezilla. You know, we are together in this. I'm going to help her all the way through it. The husband's already been warned, or the soon-to-be husband's already been warned. Get out of the way. The two words that you need to have are, yes, dear. And then the other two words are, I'm sorry. And they're interchangeable. Sometimes you start with, I'm sorry, and then you go to, yes, dear, or whatever it might be. But the whole focus upon that wedding is that you want to make this day as almost as perfect as possible. But we all know that not everything is going to be perfect. There's going to be something somewhere along the way that takes place, and you tie that to a memory, and it actually ends up many times being a good thing. Sometimes it ends up being a struggle, but most times it ends up being a good thing. So this couple that I'm marrying, they're older, and when I say older, I don't mean that they're older in terms of being married for the first time. And so a lot of times when I have couples, they're usually in their 20s. Every once in a while, I'll do some in their 30s, and occasionally a little bit older as far as that goes. And it just happens that this couple's, you know, late 30s, early 40s, and they waited. They waited until this time for both of them for the first time being married. And so going up to it, you think, oh, this would be so much easier because they've kind of lived life and they, you know, understand things. She had a daughter, and the daughter is now 18, so it should be even easier. And you're going through step of the way, and this will be a piece of cake. Getting to this wedding, for whatever reason, in the last few weeks became so difficult for them. And I just kept praying for them, and I kept, you know, lifting them up, and it didn't matter what was going on. There was just this constant uneasiness. But then when I would talk with them, it was amazing how, after just talking for a little bit, talking it out and having a discussion and having a conversation, all that would seem to go away. So whenever that happens, you realize that, you know, it's probably not the actual wedding or the ceremony or any of those things that are taking place. They're outside sources. So for the bride, especially if she is someone who is putting most of the things together for the wedding, you know, she's also the caterer, and she's also the manager of the band, and she's also, you know, making sure the DJ or the sound guy is there, and she's making sure that, you know, all the girls have their times of getting their hair ready, and that all the guys are going to stay sober enough so that they can wake up early enough for the next day, you know, to actually get to the wedding. And these all sound like crazy things, but they're all true things that actually take place. And so it's more and more difficult for them. And so if you can find whatever that is to not only to mark this time, but to make it easier on her especially, it just takes everything away. And so we got to the wedding rehearsal Friday night, and I got there and I could not believe what had taken place. There was zero stress. I talked to him twice during the week, and I wasn't worried that the marriage wasn't going to go off or the wedding wasn't going to go off. I was just more worried that there would be so much stress that it was going to be difficult for them to get through the day. We got there, and it was just like everything's good. And the reason everything was good was because the bride was just so at peace that it made everyone around her at peace. But part of it was she chose the right people to be around her. So if you're someone that's young, or if you're someone that, you know, your daughter or son is going to be getting married, coming up at some point, let them know. Make it easy, because relationships should be easy. Choose people that are going to make it easy. Choose people that are fun and funny and that are going to keep it light. If they're too serious, if they're too bossy, if they're too arrogant, if they're too prideful, if they're all those things that God is not, then, let them park the cars. Seriously, that's what you want those people to do. So, but in the wedding party itself, you want to have that, because it makes the actual wedding time so much easier for everyone. So we get there, she's calm to the point that everyone's like, I'll have two of whatever she's having. Everyone was really, really good. We go through and we do the entire rehearsal, and she's everything has to stay step by step. We landed exactly on the minute for the next step, and everyone was able to go on and move on with their evening, and then for the next day to come to the wedding. And I still didn't have an answer as to why, even though I knew everything that was going on, because as a pastor, you've got to find out, okay, this dynamic and that dynamic, and this is what's going on with the family, and that's what's going on with the family. And I understood all the different pieces and parts, but it didn't come together until the next day. So that got me thinking that, when it's time for a message, even though we know that what we're talking about is the next psalm, and the next psalm, this is book 4, by the way, so we're taking a different psalm for each week, we still don't know sometimes like where that message is going to go for us. But the message for each one of us is a personal message. And so when I say to you, what are important dates in your life, your dates may be different dates than what other people have. All of you have, I would think that an important date would be the day that you were born. But that, for the most part, is a different date for all of us. For some of you, an important date is the day that you got married. For some of you, the date is the day that you had a child, or a second child, or a third, fourth, and fifth child. For some of you, the date, who knows, it could be the date that you graduated from college, or the date that you graduated from high school because you were finally out, the day that you passed that final exam. We all have these days that we can mark, and when we look back at those days, the meaning that is tied to it, many times what we find, especially as a believer, is that I wouldn't have got to that day, or that day wouldn't have been possible had it not been for God in my life. Now, for others, it kind of goes the other side. It was the day that sadly, I had a really, really nasty breakup. And it took me years and years and years to get through that. But when I finally was on the backside of it, I saw that God was working through that time and in that time. And had I not paid attention, I may have made an even worse mistake that I would have walked with in my life. That could happen with relationships. It could happen being engaged and choosing not to be engaged. It could be, making a decision of staying too long or being somewhere where you shouldn't be. There's always those times. But when you get through those, you can look back and say, I couldn't see it at the time and I didn't recognize it, but God was in control of it. So the psalmist today that writes this psalm understood all of those things. But here's the most amazing part. This psalm was actually written by Moses. And Moses, depending on how you look at it, Genesis and Job were written right about the same time by two separate writers way off that both knew who God was. But this may have actually been written before anything else you've ever read in the Bible. And the theme that he has about this psalm is the same theme that we take place and that we take with us every single day. And it's a desire that we all have. Psalm 90, and we'll dive into the whole part here in a little bit. I'm just going to read this verse, Jason and Rick. Psalm 90, verse 12 says this, and this is the hinge verse. It says, teach us to number our days aright so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. So if I just said that to you and said, man, we got to learn, because God wants to teach us. We have to learn how to number our days so that we can gain God's wisdom. if we just shared that with other people, they would tell you that's a really good idea. Man, if we could just figure out, you know, that, you know, on Sunday, on Monday, on Tuesday, how to do that. If we could get that through the weekend, because on Fridays I really struggle with it because by then I've so checked out of everything that I don't even know where I'm at. And then on Sunday I get to start over again. See, we mark those days, that Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. We mark it with the day of the month. This is the 14th, and we'll go to the end of July and the 31st. And you know what? July was a struggle month for me. I always seem to struggle in that month, but August 1st, I get to start over. On Sunday, I get to start over. So we continually mark the time that we have. We'll get into that a little later. But Moses, he is saying this, how about teaching us so that when I get to those moments, I don't suddenly recognize God or look for God in them. So that when I'm walking down the aisle, I'm not suddenly giving this to God. So that when I have my first, my second, my fifth child, that all of a sudden I'm not suddenly going, okay, God, could you take over? So that when I have those really, really bad days that I go, you know what? Oh, it's Friday the 13th, and I mark that. So that I can see Him within each and every day, and I can gain His wisdom. That's a promise that God gives us. And that's what Moses is saying here, is he's saying, God, would you teach us to do that? But before he ever gets to those verses, he has an entire discussion with God. And this first psalm in which he writes to each one of us, being the first possible scripture that was ever written, the same thing was going on then as is going on now. Teach us. God, would you teach us so that we may gain your wisdom? Psalm 90 starts off with this, verse 1. It says, Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. So as we go through here, I want you to notice that there's going to be times that are going to be marked. He is going to actually bring up things that point to time. And he starts it here. He says, God, we live with you, we live in you, you are there for us, you've given us this place to live. And he says, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. So Moses, knowing that generations have come before and that generations are going to come after, he is saying, you know what, God, you had this then, you have it now, and you're going to have it in the future. So throughout all generations, and then in the next verse he says, before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Before the mountains were born, or you were brought forth the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. So throughout all generations, from everlasting to everlasting, throughout all time, you are God. Here's the amazing thing about this psalm, if you were to break this down. You can actually see within this psalm, within these 17 verses, the story of creation. And you can actually see within these 17 verses, even up to God dealing with Adam and Eve through sin that entered the world. He knew there was going to be a struggle then because he wrote about it. But this little breakdown of these 17 verses are still the age-old question and the struggles that we have even to this day. And it's not about how much money we make. And it's not about where we live. And it's not about how people treat us. And it's not about the things that rise up inside. It is how and what we do with the time that God gives us. Because, regardless of age, when that ends, each day that we have, this day that we're promised, you and I have the same number of hours, minutes, and seconds. What is it that we will do with that time? And whose time are we taking, and what are we making that for whom? I don't know if that made sense when I said that. I hope that did. Hit rewind for me. I just want to make sure Jason's awake. Who are we living that time for is basically what I'm trying to say. So, next verse he says this. You turn, and here's the next thing. You turn men back to dust, saying, return to dust, O sons of men, for 1,000 years. So here's that time again. In your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. Through the years, in day and at night. See, at this time, they didn't have watches. The time was separated by the sun and by the moon. And so when the sun went up, when it came down, when the stars came out, whatever it might be, it was literally decided by that time and by the things that God had placed in the sky. That's all they knew. But they did know enough to know that years were going by and days were going by. And the more that they went by, the closer they were to meeting God face to face. It says, for 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. So the day and the night. Brandy was coming up and doing announcements today, and for those of you who don't know, Brandy actually hates doing announcements, but she does them to help out, and which I really appreciate. And if anybody here would like to come and help with announcements, please come let me know, because it's not the easiest thing in the world, but I'd rather hear from her than me, because for obvious reasons. So, I mean, you want to hear different voices, and you want to tie people to it. It's like Denise is going to come up to share announcements in August, which is very important, because I'd rather hear Denise than I would me, and right, we all understand that, right? But here's the thing. I told her before she went there, I said, there's a thing that you have to understand about time. And God looks at time differently than we look at time. And so I was supposed to tell her this before we went out, and I forgot, but it comes in perfectly for the message. So there's this guy, and he's sitting down with God, and he's having a conversation. And he says, God, what is a dollar like to you? And God said, a dollar to me is like $1 trillion to you. The guy thought about it. He said, okay. He said, God, what is a minute like to you? And he said, a minute to me is like 1,000 years to you. So the guy thought about it. He says, hey, God, do you mind if I borrow a dollar? And God looked at him and said, sure, in a minute. But see, we mark things through the sun, and we mark things through the day, and then through the night. We still mark things the same way as when God did. What is it that we are doing the most, making the most, choosing to make the most of our time? Moses now is writing about this, and he is asking you and asking me, who is in control right now? Verse 4, for 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. You sweep men away in the sleep of death. They are like the new grass of the morning, though in the morning it springs up noon. By evening it is dry and withered. Day, evening, night, marking time. Verse 7, we are consumed by your anger. So now the human side of Moses kicks in. We're consumed by your anger and terrified by your indignation. You have set your iniquities before our secret sins in the light of your presence. All our days pass away under your wrath. We finish your years with a moan. The length of our days is 70 years or 80 if we have the strength. Yet their span is but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass away and we fly away. Who knows the power of your anger? For your wrath is as great as the fear that is due you. See, you have to remember something here. When he's writing about these things, Moses doesn't know Jesus. He doesn't know all of God's plan. He just knows that he is the mediator. He's the mediator between a chosen people that are supposed to be going to a promised land. And as he finds out along the way, it's a promised land that he's never going to get in. So I am the chosen one of the chosen people who is never going to get into the land that you promised, because I wavered a little while on my faith. And so he sees the wrathful, the anger, however you want to fill that term in, side of God that none of us want to see and none of us want to admit to. And for non-believers, the side that they want to point to the most. Well, in the Old Testament, God was mad. And in the Old Testament, there was a war. And in the Old Testament, they took care of these people. And in the Old Testament, they did this and they did that. They want to point out to all the negatives. And so many times we rest there. Moses couldn't help but rest there. That's all he knew. And so the human side of him came out, and he had a conversation with God about it. It's okay to have those conversations. But just like you and I, we now have Jesus that we can share. We can say, yeah, that part was necessary. The law was necessary so that you could understand the law side and understand God's love side. Did God get angry at times? You bet he got angry. Should he have gotten angry? Well, let me ask you a question. Take yourself back to when you were a child. When you really messed up and you knew you messed up, do you think your mom and dad should have been angry at you? The answer would be yeah. When you have a child and they do something really stupid, not that that would ever happen to any of you or your kids, but when they do something really dumb, are there times when you get angry at them? And the answer is absolutely. At times, you have to be kidding with me. How did you do that? Chandler was sharing this just the other day about how there was one time, Chandler's a really, really good arm and he throws the ball hard. He used to throw rocks hard too, and he threw them at cars as they were driving by. Because the neighbor's like, man, you throw really hard, throw that rock. And so he hit about 3 or 4 cars before one of them finally stopped. And so, I know this is going on the internet, I don't really care at this point because I don't think I'd go to jail for it. I spanked him. I know, right? Can you believe I spanked him? I spanked him. And guess what I spanked him with? A skateboard. You know why? Because that's all I could find. And if you're a six-year-old kid, you do not want to get spanked by a skateboard. And I did. And he still remembers it. And he stopped throwing rocks at cars. Good job, Dad, right? Later on, though, I had to pull him aside and say, listen, man, okay, let's talk about what really happened, and let's make sure that we don't do this again. And by the way, the skateboard's going to stay there in the corner until you're 20, just as a reminder. But there are times where we step up and we do things, and we act sometimes out of anger, out of feeling, or out of emotion, and God does that. He gives that to us. But God always gives us a way out. Moses' point here is like, man, you're always mad. You just seem like you're mad, and you're wrath, and man, it's really tough to live underneath that. And I've got all these people here that want to, you know, that want to do the right thing, but then they do something stupid, and then we end up paying for it. Yeah, that's what happened in the Old Testament. But God brought the New Testament. And God brought Jesus. And for all of those people in the Old Testament that believed, they sat in Abraham's bosom until Jesus came to get them and take them to heaven. They had a place for those that believe. And it's the same thing now. So you can share that now. What about all those people from the Old Testament? Hey, if they believed and they believed there was God, they have a place in heaven. Well, how do you know that? The Bible teaches us that Jesus went and got them and he took them to heaven with them. Well, that's really cool. Good. Let's talk about you. Let's talk about what it means to actually live before a loving God. Watch what happens next with Moses. The very next verse is our central verse. It says, teach us to number our days aright that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Now I'm going to share a name with you that many of you aren't going to know. His name is Tyler Skaggs. Some of you may know him if you're a baseball fan. Tyler Skaggs was 27 years old when a couple weeks back they found him unresponsive in his hotel room as the team was getting ready to go to a game. At the age of 27, he passed away. No foul play that they are aware of. They don't have any reason as to why, but for whatever reason, at the age of 27, he was gone. And we can't even imagine why. I mean, for his parents and everything, you have to think, oh my goodness, that had to be like the worst day ever, because they don't have any answers, and they're not going to have any answers for months and months to come. So the team has to make a decision. The team has to make a decision to honor him and to try and move forward, or to just move forward. And they chose to honor him and move forward. So that on July 13th, they played a game in honor of Tyler Skaggs, and every guy wore his number. So for the entire team, they wore his jersey for that game. The Angels combined pitching staff threw a no-hitter that day. A no-hitter. They scored 7 runs in the first inning and 13 runs for the day. They scored 7 and 13 on July 13th, which is 7-13. Their entire staff threw a no-hitter together. The last time that happened in the state of California was 27 years ago on the day that Tyler Skaggs was born. Listen, if we don't think that God marks time, and if we just think that's all a coincidence, I personally, this is just me, I think you're crazy. I don't think it happened by accident. I don't think it happened by accident when guys are coming out and going, we are praying and God has this, and they point all this to God being in control. Moses did the same thing. He's pointing to the years, the months, the days, the nights, evening, morning. Every single moment is God. And what do we do within those moments? Are we saying to God, teach us through the sickness, teach us through the disease, teach us through the loss, teach us through the bad decisions, and teach us through the great things that happen. Teach us through the people that I have alongside of me. Teach us through the family that you've blessed me with. Teach me through my mom, through my dad. Teach me through my grandchildren, through my kids. We had 2 little kids up here today. Riley was up here with mom, and then when Rick was walking through with the offering, he had his grandson. Cutest kid in the world. Just grab his face, and I mean, it's just, he'll just stare at you. But wasn't that awesome? Wasn't it great to see that? This is the thing that we need to do when it comes to the wisdom that God gives us. He is teaching us, and we need to teach others. And Moses understood that completely. Now, that's a wonderful story, isn't it? I'm going to finish with a better one. I don't know, I want to say better one. It's going to be a different one because that whole thing with Tyler Skaggs amazed me. But let's watch what happens next. Verse 13 says, "Relent, O Lord, how long will it be? Have compassion on your servant." So now Moses on this side is going, hey, you know what? Who's in control? You are, you know, but this is the human side of me because I'm struggling. And now on the opposite side of the verse, he's saying this, "Have compassion on your servant." I'm kind of in the middle here. "Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing life." So in the morning, "that we may sing for joy and be glad for all of our days. Make us glad as many days as you have afflicted us, for many years as we have seen trouble. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to their children." So we hand it on. Let us pass it on. Let us see that you're God. Let us teach others. Let us be taught by you, and then show that to our children and our children's children. Verse 17, "May the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. Establish the work of our hands for us." Yes, establish the work for your hands. So in these last set of verses, Moses says this, hey, restore us daily, renew us, but establish the work that we have before you so that we can see you, and that by us seeing you, that others can see you. See, Moses was being taught, and he wrote it down to pass on to the generations. So we get to this wedding yesterday, and the story behind the story was this. Usually when I have to do a wedding, there are two families that are involved. And occasionally there might be step-parents or just different things like that, so that there might be a third family, but realistically there's just two families involved. This family, however, the young man that was being married was adopted. And on Father's Day of this year, his now stepdaughter has asked him to adopt her. And so he is now going to be her legal father, which is really cool in and of itself because he got adopted, right? But to mark time, when he was about 36, 37 years old, in that age group somewhere, his now wife, realizing that he was adopted, and this daughter went on a search, and they found his real mom. And they tracked down the phone number and sent her a text message and said, "Does this date mean anything to you?" And on the opposite side, this woman saw that and said, "That date means a lot to me." And then the phone rang. And they picked it up and said, "Do you know this name?" And she said, "No, I don't know this name." And said, "Does this date mean anything to you?" And she said, "Oh, it means a lot." Said, "Well, that name that we just gave you is your son." And she said, "I've been waiting for this phone call my entire life. Just waiting." As fate would have it, he lost his real mom, or his adopted mom, 8 years ago. And so for that wedding yesterday, his real mom sat where the mother sits, while her mother sat where the bride's mother sits. And three families were brought together, all because of a decision that one woman made however many years ago. Now it's about 39 years ago. Because she chose to do what God would have her do. And even though it was rough, and she knew that she wasn't ready, and she knew that she couldn't care for a child, she gave up that child, and she told me, she said, "John, I was not ready, and I couldn't, but I knew that I couldn't give up this child." And she said, "About 10 years ago, I finally was at peace because she became a believer, and she allowed God to work through her. And she allowed God to mark those days. And she didn't know when it was coming, but she prayed for the hope that her child would reach out to her. And that child did. And the very last thing that anybody expected through this had actually taken place. And the adopted son is now adopting a daughter because there's an absence of a father in her life. And had the original mom not made that choice, that day never comes together. God marked it. He marked it years and years ago. A decision was made based on God. She wasn't where she needed to be. That son was raised by a loving adoptive family. He was raised as a believer. His wife was also a believer. They were raised in the same church, never met. They were in the same 2 and 3 year old department, didn't even know it. Her parents got married in that church. His parents got married in that church, had no idea, because they ended up going separate ways at some point. And yet God continued to bring them back together. So when this war that was taking place all the way coming through, she even recognized, she's like, it had nothing to do with God. It had everything to do with every outside force to try to keep us away from each other, but God had bigger plans. And that is what we need to understand. Every day, every night, every month, every year that we mark for God, we start within those moments and we allow it when the sun is out and when the sun is away. That if we will choose to be taught by God and to understand that every moment is tied to eternity, we can't help but be changed by Him and through it to gain God's wisdom. First scripture ever written. Most likely, the first scripture ever written. Teach us, God, to number our days so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Your heart of wisdom is still what we seek today. The praise team is going to come up. We're going to go like we've been doing this for the last 3 or 4 weeks. And they're going to play, Cody's going to play on his guitar. And I'm going to read you this psalm. And so what I ask of you is just right where you sit, if you just close your eyes and just rest in that and just listen to the words that were written then. The oldest words, most likely the oldest words ever written in Scripture. And when it gets to that verse 12 about teaching us, that you will ask God, God, I know I've got struggles, just like Moses wrote, but I also know that you love me. And Lord, I want you to restore me daily and establish the work that you have for me, for you. Would you all bow your heads and close your eyes with me for a second? God, teach us. Your word is there to teach us. God, teach us so that we may gain wisdom. Lord, help us to know that the time that we have here together has been marked by you. Lord, help us to know that we can see things on the backside. We can see you at work, but sometimes it's so difficult in the moment. We have loss. We have tragedy. We have questions that we can't answer. God, sometimes we have so many blessings, it's even difficult to count them. But we constantly wait for the other shoe to drop. But instead, Lord, help us to live this day, this night, this week, this month, this year, with a different mindset. Help us to learn from the words of Moses, and help us to teach us to number our days so that we may gain your wisdom. Lord, you have been our dwelling place throughout all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn men back to dust, saying, return to dust, O sons of men. For 1,000 years in your sight are like a day that has just gone by, or like a watch in the night. You sweep men away in the sleep of death. They are like the morning new grass of the morning. Though in the morning it springs up new, by evening it is dry and withered. We are consumed by your anger and terrified by your indignation. You have set our iniquities before our secret sins in the light of your presence. All our days pass away under your wrath. We finish our years with a moan. The length of our days is 70 years or 80 if we have the strength. Yet their span is but trouble and sorrow, for they quickly pass and we fly away. Who knows the power of your anger? For your wrath is as great as the fear that is due you. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Relent, O Lord, how long will it be? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad for all our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, for as many years as we have seen trouble. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to their children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Would you all please stand?